Before we get into the concept of theories of failure, let's first study the state of stress in a uniaxial tensile test specimen. So in a simple tensile test, we have a specimen like this. A specimen is there and you are applying a load. We keep on increasing the load until the stress also increases. When stress reaches its yield point stress, we'll say the component has yielded. So for us, yielding is a failure. Okay, so the condition for yielding or a failure is when sigma y reaches sigma yield point. In a simple tensile test, as you can see, we are only applying load in the y direction. So in the x direction, in the z direction, we don't have any load. Okay, so it's a uniaxial test case. Now the logic, the concept that we have got from this simple tensile test is whenever sigma y reaches the sigma yield point, the component will yield. Okay, so you can take another specimen, okay, and simply directly apply sigma y is equal to whatever value you got in the previous test, the component will start yielding. Okay, now the question is, can the same yielding be replicated if there are other component of forces? So let's take another specimen here, a three-dimensional specimen here, okay, and now we are applying all the stress components. We are applying sigma x, we are applying sigma y, we are applying sigma z, okay, all the components are applied, and the material being same, let's say in the earlier case we got a yield point of 200 MPa. Now what we do is we'll make sigma y is equal to 200 MPa in this case, but we'll make other stresses more than that. Let's say let this be a compressive stress of 300 or so. So can we say, or let me say not 300, let's say even lesser than that, say let's say it is 150, this is also 150. So can we now say that material has yielded just because the UTM gave the value of 200 in this case also, where there is actually three-dimensional stress state? Can we say that material has yielded? No, we cannot say. You can sometimes, it may so happen even when sigma y is equal to 200, it is the yield point value obtained from the UTM machine or a simple tensile test machine, the actual specimen may not actually yield, because the yielding is governed not only by the sigma y, it is governed by the other components also, sigma x, sigma y, sigma z, and tau xy, tau z, and tau z. All other components will have their effect in determining whether a component has yielded or not. So from experience, therefore, we have understood that yielding is not governed by just one stress component. So yielding is not governed by sigma y alone, but it is governed by all other components also. So what we try to do in this case, in case of theories of failure, is we want to find some value which is average, not exactly average. Average in the sense it's just addition and divided by number of terms, a sort of average, a kind of average. When we measure this, we'll be able to tell whether the component is yielded or not. So this average or any modulus or something like that will take care of all other components and will arrive at some value. So by measuring this value, we can tell a component has failed or not. So in effect, it is not just enough to measure sigma y and decide whether yielding has occurred or not. So what these theories of failure say is you have to measure all the components, all the six components of stress, and take some sort of average and make that average, calculate that average. That average will determine whether the component has yielded or not. So basically we are saying component, the yielding is governed by all the components, not just one component, that is sigma y, as in case of simple tensile test. So when we want to use the results of simple tensile test to other cases where the loads are not just uniaxial, they are multiaxial, then we have to use theories of failure. So as we already discussed, if it is a ductile material, we will say failure is nothing but yielding itself. The moment it starts yielding, we'll say component has failed. For a brittle material, as you are aware, there is no yield point stress. So we will say the moment it fractures, that is a failure. So for ductile, yielding, and for brittle, fracture is a failure criteria. Now in this course, we will study various kinds of theories of failure, or the most common kinds of theories of failures used. So for ductile material, so we said ductile material, the failure theories for ductile materials are also known by the name yield criteria, because we use yield point as the limiting value, yield point as the maximum value. So these theories are known as yield criteria, and that is the theories of failure for ductile materials. The first one is called maximum shear stress theory, also known as MSS. So this maximum shear stress theory is also known by two other names. One is it may be also called as Tresca theory, or it is called Guest theory. So most commonly the Tresca name is used in addition to maximum shear stress theory. So this is the first theory that we use for ductile materials. And for ductile materials, the other most popular theory in comparison to other theories is distortion energy theory, and most popularly called von Mises theory. Sometimes they may also use the word Mises-Encke theory or shear energy theory, octahedral theory. All that can be used. The most popular among them is von Mises theory in addition to distortion energy theory. So among these two, distortion energy theory is popular compared to the maximum shear stress theory. And the third one is, it's called ductile Coulomb Moore theory. So this is particularly useful for ductile materials which are uneven in nature. That means their properties are different in tensile and compression. Then we use this theory called ductile Coulomb Moore theory. So first one is maximum shear stress theory. Second one is distortional energy theory, also known as von Mises theory. And the third one is ductile Coulomb Moore theory. Okay. So these three theories are used for ductile materials. If it is even, so we'll go with the first two methods. If it is uneven, we'll go with the third method. So these three theories are used for ductile materials. Now when we come to brittle materials, we know there is no yield point. And the ultimate tensile stress is used as a criteria. That is, ultimate tensile stress is your maximum stress. And as these theories are called fracture criteria. So because the failure here is governed by the fracture of component. In this, we study three more theories. The first one is called maximum normal stress theory. Maximum normal stress theory. This is also known by the name Rankine's theory. And then we have a second theory. It's called brittle Coulomb Moore theory. It's similar to Coulomb Moore theory, except that it is used for brittle materials. And then we have another theory called modified Moore theory. So this is brittle Coulomb Moore theory. Another one is modified Moore theory. So these three theories are used for brittle material. Out of this, if the brittle material has got same properties in both tension and compression, that is, if it is even material, we'll use maximum normal stress theory or Rankine's theory. And if it is uneven, so we'll go for one of these two theories. However, it is to be noted that most of the ductile brittle materials are basically uneven in nature. So most of the time we'll be using this theory, these two theories also. In addition to these theories, as a part of our historical perspective, we will study two more theories under the category of historical theories of failure. The first one is maximum principal strain theory, also known as St. Venant's theory. Okay. And the second one is total strain energy theory, also known as Beltrami and Haig theory. These two theories are studied only for the academic purpose only. These are not used in the industry or not in your academic circle also. Just out of curiosity, we are studying these two. However, they are gaining popularity these days because people are trying to use these theories for composite materials also. But however, as of now, for the materials or the metals, we'll restrict our attention to those six theories that we discussed above, three for ductile and three for brittle materials. Okay, to properly understand each theories of failure, we have to first study the state of stress in a component. So if you take a specimen or a component subjected to some load, at this point I want to study what is the load or what is the stresses that are there. So imagine there is some body here and it is subjected to some load or some bending moment or whatever. So if you want to study the stress at this point, if we have to take a small cubical element from this part and study what are the stresses on this. So that particular cubical element, okay, is shown enlarged here. This is the enlarged portion of that cubical element. On this cubical element, you will find totally 9 stress components, out of which 3 are dependent. So effectively, there will be 6 stress components given by sigma x, sigma y, and sigma z, and tau xy, tau yz, and tau zx.